Eric, you have recently suggested that the demand for oil is back to pre-pandemic levels. You've also suggested that we're in for a multi-year bull market. Can you get into your thesis a bit? And of course, travel hasn't really gone into full effect. What might that demand do to growth?
Absolutely. It's pretty encouraging that we are back to pre-COVID levels for global oil demand with a still weak jet fuel market, notably on leisure travel, as it's still a pain to travel with your family. That should be passing in the next couple of months. Why I believe that we're in a multi-year bull market for oil centers around two main principles, and that is the demand for oil, I believe, will continue for at least the next 10 years. But the real exciting part of the bull thesis revolves around supply. There are natural gating factors, whether it's access to financing, investors' demands, the lack of new spare capacity on the part of OPEC, the lack of projects on the part of the global supermajors, that are meaning that supply growth is challenged going forward. We've already had a sharp reduction in global oil inventories, inventory levels, and it has a great negative correlation to the oil price. And the market's taken almost 300 million barrels just in the past 1 year. Why? It's because demand has exceeded to the upside, but there are constraints on supply, and that remains true going forward. We're in an era of post-US shale hypergrowth. US shale is no longer growing more than global demand, and so there's a call on OPEC. There's a call on global supermajors, but they can't pick up, and they can't pick up because we're looking at the exhaustion of OPEC's spare capacity in the coming months, and we also see the continuation of lack of sufficient investment on the part of the global supermajors, which really started back in 2014. And that trend is only getting worse because of ESG pressures, the demand for investors that these companies need to decarbonize and reach net zero status by 2050. It's starving them of the necessary capital to be able to invest in new projects, meet global oil demand, and offset global declines.
OPEC meeting just around the corner. Is there a thought that they might call on countries to ramp up production?
OPEC is currently underproducing their quota. And so there's some countries like a Nigeria, like an Angola. Why are they underproducing? Why are they forsaking hundreds of millions of dollars every single month? It's not because of benevolence. It's because just like the global supermajors, they have had the inability to invest in new productive capacity. And the great thing with the oil and gas business is if you don't spend money and invest in new production, you don't stay flat, you fall. And so there are very few members of OPEC that can actually meaningfully grow oil production. Many of them, including Russia, frankly, are probably near their peak productive capacity. And so quotas might come on month after month after month, and yet OPEC in aggregate is challenged to answer. And that's why I think we're looking at OPEC's spare capacity exhaustion by the end of this year. And that will be one of the most bullish catalysts for the oil price in modern history, because OPEC has always acted as that shock absorber. The world's becoming more and more volatile. We've got Russia and Ukraine, et cetera. As at the end of this year, there'll be no shock absorber to be able to handle any disruptions because of geopolitical events.
Let's get into some of the geopolitical risks. Russia, Ukraine making headlines. What might Western sanctions do to exports there? And of course, let's bring U.S.-Iran into the conversation.
My best guess is if Russia invades into Ukraine, you will not get sanctions on oil. The United States, the world does not want higher oil prices. The only people in the world that do are energy investors in OPEC, oil-producing countries. And so with midterm elections, I don't think a Biden administration can allow the oil price to go up much further. That's why I think that there's probably a high likelihood of some semblance of agreement with Iran that allow for relaxations of their oil exports in the second half of this year. You might think that's a negative. I actually will be relieved because one, the market's going to need the oil. It's going to be it's already tight. It'll be even tighter without Iranian barrels. So it doesn't derail the thesis, the multi-year bull market thesis. And at the same time, Iran has always been that elephant in the room. It's that last lingering area of curtailed volumes that could easily, supposedly easily come online. And if we get that out of the way, it just negates one of those last reasons why some generalist investors have not been wanting to invest in this space.
You seem biased to Canadian companies with this theme of return to shareholders. Give us an idea of what this looks like and what this means for Canadian companies, I guess, going forward, and the investment, perhaps lack of focus on decarbonization.
It's shocking to some people, including myself, but the generalist investor is still stuck in this apathetic coma. They're not recognizing the opportunity. And I've been a believer that what shakes them out of that coma is meaningful action on the part of energy companies through increasing dividends, paying dividends, doing meaningful share buybacks. And that's really the call of global energy investors around the world. What allows companies to return the most amount of free cash flow back to investors are long life reserves, low corporate declines, and strong balance sheets. Canada has the best of all three of those attributes of any jurisdiction in the world, and yet our energy stocks remain depressed. We're one of the cheapest jurisdictions in the world. And so I'm very optimistic that we'll be able to catch up to our global peers and also then benefit from stocks. You know, they're discounting around approximately $60 right now in an $88, $89 world. I think we potentially see 100 by the end of this year and then trade there for the next several years. And so when I look at Canadian companies at $100 oil, with free cash flow, they could privatize themselves. They could buy back every single share outstanding in just 2.6 years. And yet they're sitting on average 15 years of drilling inventory. And so as an investor today, you're literally getting over a decade's worth of drilling inventory, production, free cash flow, dividends, buyback potential, all of that for literally nothing, given where energy stocks are trading today. So yes, you know, energy stocks have had a good run, but I think there's a lot more to go. Just even using $100 oil, I think we ultimately trade higher than that. My measured upside for the sector is over 120% from here. And that's after a stellar year last year where, you know, my fund was up 186% as an example.
Eric, some analysts have suggested that Brent at $90 US a barrel is high, yet you're calling for $100. Yeah. How high can it go?
Yeah, we're not high. We're just back to normal. You know, if we look at global inventories within OECD countries, we're approaching where inventory levels were back in the period of 2010 to 2014. Why is that important? That was a four-year time period where oil averaged over $100 and yet demand continued to grow. We're not yet at the point where it's too expensive, where discretionary demand falters. That's historically been when oil is about 5 to 6% of the global GDP. What does that mean? It sounds pretty academic. We don't see demand destruction until we hit $130 to $140 per barrel. So that's ultimately where I think we go, if not higher, because we tend to overshoot. And with exhausting shale or spare capacity, and then the end of US shale hypergrowth, the fundamental setup today is much, much, much more bullish than it was back in 2010 to 2014.
Lastly, you had mentioned global super majors at the start of the conversation. As these companies hustle to hit decarbonization targets, what is that going to do to oil supply?
So the need to reach net zero by 2050, the demand of, you know, the eco woke that these companies need to pledge net zero and they need to take money out of, you know, dirty oil, et cetera, and invest it into very low margin businesses like offshore wind and renewables, what it's doing is starving them of the necessary capital to invest in new production. If we look at global supermajors, you know, investment peaked in 2014 and it fell because of the collapse in the oil price. Historically, oil is up sharply this year and last year. You would have expected a meaningful increase in investment. We are not seeing that. And part of the reason is this narrative around the need to improve ESG ratings and invest in decarbonization, et cetera. What it's setting us up for is a oil supply crisis. You and I will be consuming oil for the rest of our lifetimes. That demand will be increasing for at least the next 10 odd years. But the fear of peak demand is leading to the reality of peak supply. The uncertainty about what the long-term outlook for oil looks like is disallowing investment on the parts of corporate boards and the global supermajors to sanction multi-billion dollar projects that take 4 to 6 years to come online, another 4 years for each project payout. What company, what board in their right mind would do that when the path of least resistance is to pay down debt, pay a dividend, increase a dividend, moderate growth, moderate your corporate decline, et cetera, because that's what investors want. Investors want returns. They don't want growth. The flip side to that is it's going to equate to a meaningfully higher oil price in the quarters and years to come.